have enjoyed the afternoon in Hoi An yesterday. So our first speaker this morning is Joan Porti from Barcelona. And he's been talking about twisted Alexander polynomials and hyperbolic volumes, four knots.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm very glad to be here. I thank the organizers for the opportunity to speak. So I will talk about a joint work in progress. So what is not a conjecture is not yet a theorem, but it will be a theorem. So. And this is a collaboration with Leo Benard. He's in Geneva, in Switzerland, and Joan Dubois and Michael Heusener, who are in France, in Clermont-Ferrand. Okay, so here, let me start with the theorem. So that's the setting. The setting will be a hyperbolic knot. And we take the holonomy representation of this knot, which is in SL to C, and we lift it to SL to C. We have two lifts, you know that. It depends on the sign of the meridian, but whatever lift you take, you compose with an n-dimensional representation, which is the only unique, irreducible, holomorphic representation in dimension n of SL to C, into SLN. In fact, into some SON or whatever. Okay? And you consider the composition of the representation that I will denote by rho n. So there is an ambiguity with the lift of the holonomy, but I will not care about it. It's not important. And you consider the twist Alexander polynomial. I will give definitions of everything later, but just to introduce the theorem. Okay. So the theorem that it's in progress is that if you take a unique complex number and you take the evaluation at this unit complex number and the sequence of representations n and this the evaluation of the twist Alexander polynomials, absolute value, logarithm, and you divide by n squared, this converges to 1/4, 1/4 pi times the volume of the complement.
So independent of zeta?
Independent of zeta. Yeah, that's it doesn't depend on which zeta you take. It just depends on the modulus of zeta. And, well, what is this? And to, I really have to point, because maybe we'll put, well, maybe I touch nothing, because if I start to touch it, I mean, there is some obstruction between my computer and this, but it's okay.
Should I find you a stick?
No, I'm happy with this. There are sticks there, thank you. it's just a transmission, so I like to be in this side, but I would put in this side. That's true also for manifolds with class for limns, but you have to be careful with the definition of the Alexander twist Alexander polynomial. And when here we just have an abelianization map, when you take your abelianization map, just as you really cannot take the abelianization, you have to take a surjection. Does it? That's more delicate, I will not talk about this. Just, you have to be careful with the definition of the Alexander polynomial, but you will see the techniques I'm not really using, that's a knot, and I will use hyperbolic manifolds more than knots, okay? So when the zeta is one, this was proved by Goda, and these amounts were a result of Riley master torsion that I proved with a former PhD student in 2014, and this was already based on the work of Mueller, of Werner Mueller in 2012, published in 2013 for closed manifolds. Okay? But I will explain all this during the talk. Okay, so let me give you the plan of the talk. So that's the theorem. So we'll start talking about Rademeister torsion, because this is in fact a theorem on Rademeister torsions. Yeah? As you know, the twist Alexander polynomials are related, and then I will talk about twist Alexander polynomials. And to talk about the ingredients of the proof of Mueller, so the version for closed manifolds, I will have to talk about analytic torsion and ruleless zeta functions, and how the proof of Mueller works. So to explain the proof of Mueller, I will have to introduce two tools. And then I will explain how do you use Mueller's proof to prove it first for cast manifolds. Well, in fact, this is the proof when zeta is equals 1, and this is the proof when zeta equals difference from 1. But this will become clear later. Okay, so let me start with Rademeister torsion, just plan Rademeister torsion. Maybe most of you know Rademeister torsion better than myself, but I just want to explain, before giving the formal definition, one example And the better example is the initial example of Franz and Rademaster from 1935. So Lenz's spaces are their attribute to Dietzel, 1908. And as you know, they are the quotient of the action of the cyclic group with p elements on the unit sphere in C2. So in the first coordinate, you rotate by 2 pi over p, and you take the same rotation few times on the second coordinate, okay? And you know that's a space, you know the classification and all that, but for the moment, the first invariant that you find immediately is the fundamental group, and then the natural question was to ask for which q and q prime you get the same space. You know the answer, but let me recall that, well, it's easy to see that if you take the complex, you conjugate the second coordinate, you change q to minus q, and if you switch coordinates, you switch the role and you take the inverse, yeah? And the problem in 1908, after 1908, was to see that these words, they were the only ambiguities. Yeah? Why do you get always the same? It's to classify this space. And that's when Franz and Rademaster, they introduce the torsion, more or less at the same time. I think it's called Rademaster torsion. Some people call it Franz Rademaster. Rademaster proved it for in the three-dimensional case. Franz gave the odd dimensional classification, I think. But I confess I didn't read the papers in German from 1935. It's beyond my possibilities. I trust what people say. Okay, so how do you define the torsion that classifies Lenz space? So you use the stereographic projection of the three sphere, okay? And you represent one circle. You take one of the coordinates equal to zero, and you have these two circles in the Hopf, forming the Hopf limn. And the action of your group is, when one of the coordinates is a rotation by angle 2 pi over p, and in the other coordinate is 2 pi times q over p. No? And this determines the action because it's just the journey of this. Okay, you have this action. What did they do, Franz and Rademaster? They took, you take a fundamental domain. And the fundamental domain, you call it, what is this? Legs, okay? That goes from, you take one of the arguments, theta 1, from 0 to 2 pi over p. Okay, that's just taking a segment here, and you take the join with the circle. And this happens to be a free cell. I use the notation tilde E3 because that's the lift of a free cell on the Lenz space. That's a fundamental domain. Mm-hmm. And then you take a cell structure. And the cell structure is, okay, you have the boundary, you have the two cells, which is E2 tilde and the orbit of E2 tilde, and you divide the circle into P cells, which is E1 and some cell which is E0 that I didn't write, and you take all the orbits. And you write formally the boundary. You write formally the boundary. Well, first, this gives you a set decomposition of the Lenz space, and you write, you use the group ring or whatever language you like, the boundary with three tilde is t minus 1 in the two cell. I'm a little lazy with the orientation there, but at plus or minus. The boundary V2, you take the orbit of the one cell, so you have all elements of the group, and the orbit of the one cell is t to the power of r minus 1, the zero cell, okay? So because you have to take r the inverse of q modulo p, yeah, because in this factor is acting as a rotational angle 2 pi q over p. And what did Rademaster and Franz do? They replaced the element of the group by, now you take a primitive, well, not primitive, a non-trivial root of unity. C to the power of some zeta, or whatever, C, I don't remember which, some Greek letter, the power of p is 1, which is different from what I recited the slide, so I don't remember what I wrote in Latin 2 years ago. Okay? And what you get, this is what you are really doing, you are taking a representation of your group. Okay? That's what you are doing. And you say the boundary map, now this, well, that's a boundary map, you take the iterate twice is 0, but when you replace this here, your root here, you get a 0. Okay? And what you get an acyclic complex, an acyclic chain complex, so you say that the homology of chain complex is trivial. And the proof the definition of Rademeister torsion is that you take the product of these two numbers, you take the absolute value, and that's an invariant. That's an invariant, and not only it's a combinatorial invariant, but it gives the combinatorial classification of Lenz spaces. If you take all the roots of all non-trivial roots, and you look at these invariants, this gives you the classification. Okay, this gets the classification of Lenz space, the combinatorial one, the topological one, came later. The only thing that you need to keep in mind from this is that you can construct this kind of complexes, okay, with set decompositions. You take a representation of your group and you have a twist chain complex. And well, in this case, it's very simple. You just take the product of these matrices, of these elements. In general, you will have matrices, you have to take determinants, blah, blah. It will be a little more involved. But that's the idea of Rademeister torsion. A very it's a combinatorial invariant, a very superficial idea, if you want. Okay? So that's, here comes the formal definition. So what we have, we have a C-double complex that I call K. So not a knot theorist, for me K is a C-double complex, but in this talk K is also a knot, but not in this slide. And you take a representation, take it with determinant one, sometimes I will skip this determinant one, but for the moment take it with determinant one. So you take the twist chain complex. So that's the free abelian group on the cells of the universal covering. You have an action of the fundamental group on the left. You take your vector space, you have to be careful, you take an action on the right, and this gives you a chain complex. And you look at the boundary map and you want to look at determinants of these things. If you want to take determinants, what you have to do, you need bases of the vector spaces, yeah? Because you need matrices. If you want matrices, you need bases. So the natural way to construct a basis is the following one. You take a vector for VK, a basis for the vector space. The notation is not very nice here. I take i-dimensional cells of K, I take a lift of those cells to the universal covering, and this take this tensor product, and this is a basis of the vector space. Okay? Of this complex. So of the either of this, yeah, that's a vector space, the e-dimensional twist chain complex. And to compute determinants of the boundary map, the trick is the following one. You take, well, there are many ways to introduce torsion, but one way, a quick way, is this one. B1, BI, call BI the image of the boundary operator, so the boundaries. You don't have any cohomology, so you have an exact sequence. And what you do is you take a basis for in each dimension, in each BI, and here you can form a basis from BI here, and a basis here, and you lift it. So BI minus 1 tilde means a basis on this, which is lift here. And the idea is that, well, the Rademeister torsion, you take the determinants of those guys. So this is the matrix that expresses this basis with respect to that one. And you take the determinants and you take the alternative product, and that's it's well known that this does not depend on the choices and so on. That's a combinatorial invariant. There is a subtle point here, is that it's the convention that we are going to use. Here you can put, that's an alternative product, but here you can put I or I plus 1. In this talk, it will be I plus 1. And I will explain why. So that's a convention of, that's one of the conventions of Rademeister torsion. You could take the inverse of that, 1 over that. But this will create some, we'll see that. We'll see, this has some consequences.
So that would be the inverse
of the torsion. I mean, I can even define the torsion like this on 1 over this. Because I'm going to use analytic torsion, and analysts are very coherent with notation. Topologists use both conventions, analysts only use one convention. And every time I use analytic torsion, I use analyst convention. Okay? So sometimes you will find 1 over this, and you will see that some of the formulas are twisted, are complicated. This is for the combinatorial torsion, but I need to work with analytic torsion. So let me spend some time talking. Well, just one comment is that I forget to say that if this is non-zero, if there is some cohomology, this is not an exact sequence, you have to introduce basis homology, but this definition is similar. I will not get into that. Let me talk, now it's for twist and Alexander polynomials. So I'm talking about nodes, so I have the abelianization map that I call it alpha, where the abelianization composed with the representation into the invertibles in the polynomial ring with coefficients for the moment in Q, it could be seen. And, well, you know, there is a theorem of Mueller that says that the, what is a hand? I didn't see before. There's a theorem of Mueller that says that, well, this is essentially the same thing as the Alexander polynomial, the torsion of this, of the knot twist by this representation. You probably know the formula, the inverse of this formula, yeah? That's the convention of the torsion I'm using. So if you use the other convention, it's Alexander polynomial divided by t minus 1. And this t minus 1 comes from the fact that this representation is not acyclic. You have homology for a node. That's a trivial coefficient. Okay. And then there is a twist Alexander polynomial introduced by Goda and Limn. I'm not going to give the definition. I guess you are more familiar than me with twist Alexander polynomials. It's a Lorentz polynomial, and it's related to Rademeister torsion. You could define it as Rademeister torsion. And again, it's 1 over the Alexander polynomial, because I'm using the analyst convention for Rademeister torsion. Well, it's the torsion of weak representation of rho tensor by this alpha. This alpha that's the abelianization. Okay? If the representation is acyclic. If it's not acyclic, you may have some factors like this. Some cohomology, but this may appear. This may appear like this for the twist, for the trivial. So this foreseen that what I'm really going to use, here I should put my rho n. Sorry, I forget an n. That's the problem with the slides at the last minute. So my evaluation of the twist Alexander polynomial will be 1 over 1 torsion, and I will work with other master functions. But I will come to that. So now let me go to analytic torsion. Now let's go into the mind of analysis. So to do this analytic torsion, I need to work with closed manifolds, so smooth closed manifolds, yeah? Because you'll see why in a minute, in a second. And I take a representation into SLNR. I was working with representations into SLNC, but you can see SLNC into SLN2R. Okay? And if you do geometric analysis, you work with Laplacians of forms. So the first thing we do with the representation is to construct a flat vector bundle to use by the representation. That's somehow very easy, very standard. And you look at forms, we take values on this bundle. That's the formal definition. That's the sections of the forms tensor by the bundle. It means that a differential form is the tensor product of a standard form times a section of the bundle. That's nothing else. Okay? And here we have a Laplacian, we have Hermitian metrics, and everything like the standard Laplacian works here. In particular, if your manifold is closed, the spectrum of this Laplacian, the set of eigenvalues, is discrete. It's discrete and non-negative. And here it's important to use that the manifold is compact, because otherwise the spectrum would not be discrete. Okay?
Excuse me.
Yes?
You need a metric too, right?
Yeah, I need a metric too. I didn't say, but you should put Riemannian. At the end, it will not depend on the metric, but you need a metric. You need a metric on the manifold, you need an Hermitian metric on the bundle. Yeah. Right. Thank you. Yeah, you really need metrics, otherwise. So if you assume that there is no cohomology, that this there is no random cohomology, you don't have harmonic forms. You don't have harmonic forms. Your spectrum is strictly positive. And now the Laplacian is going to play the role of the boundary operator. Yeah. And what do we like to do? What analysts like to do is to take determinants of Laplacian. But it's not so easy, yeah, to take a determinant of Laplace. And what do? Analysts are very clever people, guy, and they introduce a zeta function. They do the following thing. Instead of taking the logarithm of the Laplacian, they introduce some zeta function that's an infinite summation of eigenvalues of the spectrum of lambda to the power of minus s. And this convergence is, s is a complex number, but with the real part very large. If the real part is very large, this is going to converge. And what Ryan Singer proved in 71 is that this extends meromorphically to the whole plane. And the trick is that the derivative at the origin plays the role of minus the logarithm of the determinant. So the idea is the following one. So I read this with inverted commas because that's this. I don't care about the convergence of the sums, and I should. Yeah. If you take the formal derivative of this, just the derivative of this for large s, you have this minus logarithm that is multiplying and this minus. And the idea is that the evaluation at zero should be this formal sum, which is minus logarithm of the determinant. Well, what instead of this, the idea is that you use this as the logarithm of the determinant, and you would express the combinatorial torsion as this formal, as this sum, this finite sum. So this is p goes from one to the zero to the dimension of the manifold. This is where you would put the logarithm of the determinant. Well, you could construct a combinatorial Laplacian, taking the boundary and the adjoint and so on, and you could, and the torsion would be this, okay? But that's just the analytic torsion. It was introduced in 71 by Ryan Singer. And they conjectured that it was going to be the same as the combinatorial torsion, and in fact, it is the same, yeah? Because...
You didn't explain the P there.
P is P is the dimension.
No, but why is there a P factor in the product?
Well, because you do some algebra. I mean, it's not that if you go, I mean, I define the torsion with the determinants of the boundary bands. And now I'm using the Laplacian. So I have here I am using the determinant, and I'm using the boundary. It's not the same thing, the Laplacian to the boundary map. There is a relationship, and it's where P appears. Just some algebra. If I was able to write the boundary, yeah, there would be no p. But it's not the boundary. It's a boundary times the adjoint plus the adjoint times the boundary. So I have to do some algebra manipulation, and that's why with this p appears. Yeah. Thank you. Okay. So that's. So the theorem of Chigar and Mueller says that they are the same thing. In fact, the analytic torsion is the absolute value of the combinatorial torsion. And this theorem was first proved by Chigar and Mueller in 78, and then Mueller for orthogonal representations, and Mueller proved it for unitary representations. But it's always for closed manifolds. Huh? For knots, we don't have such analytic torsion. The spectrum of the Laplacian is not discrete. Okay. So next ingredient for the proof, it's the Rueller zeta function. It's a dynamical ingredient. So now we do the following thing. We have, again, a closed hyperbolic manifold because we are still moving with analytic torsion. And you take the following function, which is you take the product of the determinant of the identity minus rho of gamma e to the power of minus some s. S is a parameter for with large real parts, so that this converges, times the longitude of the geodesic, the length of the geodesic. Okay, and you take this sum of on all oriented primitive closed geodesics. Sorry, the sum, the product, because at some point I think of logarithms at sum, but it's just this product. Well, this product converges with this condition because you know how the length of a geodesic grow in a hyperbolic manifold. And you can prove that this converges. That's not hard to prove. What is deep is this theorem of Fried in 86 that was generalized that this well-defined zeta function, it extends meromorphically to the whole plane. And when you evaluate at zero, you get the square of the analytic torsion. Okay. You see the names Fried, Rueller, these are people in dynamical systems, and this is a theorem in dynamical systems, because these closed geodesics are the closed orbits of the dynamical system in the unit tangent bundle. So you have a, in fact, they are working on the unit tangent bundle of M3, which is topologically is M3 tangents to that. And the Riemann master torsion of a manifold tangents 2, in fact, is a square. You can prove that. It's not difficult. That, in fact, here you, what you would get is a theorem of the unit tangent bundle, but you translate it into the manifold. It's a theorem on the three. So what, why? So this is really a theorem on dynamics.
And if the representation is not acyclic, then the function blows up at zero, right? The function will have only zero.
If the representation
is not acyclic.
Yeah. If it's not acyclic, we have problems at zero. That's true. And people study the pole. I think there is a pole at zero. Yeah. I mean the acyclic case. Yeah. So this theorem is a very nice and deep theorem of Fried. He proved it for all-dimensional hyperbolic manifolds in '86. And Boethke was a student of Mueller. Because Mueller was really interested in this question to prove it for less representations into SLM.
So if the general function extends monomorphically over the net plane, is there any topological implication of that? So is there any what kind of things you can get like topologically or
geometrically? Are there topological implication in what sense?
Or there is a nice property number theory. Well, my question is, so an limit continuation or an limit extension of those like general function gives us some like additional information about some spectrum.
I cannot answer your question.
My question is basically, does theorem is good for what?
It's true for?
I mean,
for what?
Good for what? Topological, in the topological sense, why do we need those theorems?
Why?
The question is, is it useful? Should we care?
Pardon?
Should we care about this? Why?
Why should we care with theorem? You will see why should we care with this. You will see in a while because I will apply it. Thank you for. I'm sorry. I'm still under. You know, I left 3 nights ago, and last night was my jet lag night. You have to be patient with me. Sorry. Anyways, my mind is not always very clear. Often it's not very clear. Why should we care? We'll see. Yeah, thanks. Because it's not clear. I say it's a very nice theorem in dynamical systems, but it will be an ingredient in the proof of Mueller. That's why it will be important. Okay? And this is why a student of Mueller was working in this generalization of this theorem, because we are going to use that. So let's go to our setting, hyperbolic nodes. So hyperbolic nodes, let me recall the notation, I lift off the holonomy into SL2, I don't care which one. I compose with the n-dimensional reducible representation, so that's the symmetrization. Let me recall what's the symmetrization. So you have homogeneous polynomials it's a space of homogeneous polynomials on two variables, on C2 of degree in minus one. Is this true or I don't remember. Maybe n minus 2? Yeah. I'm sorry, now I realize that the notation is not very coherent with n minus 1, n minus 2. It's probably n minus 2, yeah? It's an n minus 2. Yeah. It has a. So here there is a 2 and here there is a 2. Too late.
No,
or
it's n minus 1.
It's. Have n minus 1, you put minus 2. Okay. So, but you know what are these polynomials, yeah? In terms of matrices, if you have a diagonal matrix A0, 0, 1 over A, well, the theorem is the symmetrization, the first symmetrization is the three dimensional representation. You have A squared, 1, A minus 2. The second one will be A cube, A, 1 over A, 1 over, sorry.
1 over, I'm used to the left with the hand, yeah, it's not 1 over 3 and so on, yeah? Okay, and that's the notation. So I compose this, this representation. I get a representation of my group in 2SLNC. I have this map that's the abelianization, and then I map 1 to the to this unit complex number. And well, the first thing I have to show is that I have to study when this is a cyclic, yeah, because I want to study distortions and this theorem and so on. I need to know when it's a cyclic or not, and it is a cyclic with one exception: when theta is 1 and n is odd, yeah? Because when n is odd, there are eigen values with that 1, blah blah. And this is, well, that's a theorem. You can call it a theorem, but essentially this kind of theorem was proved by Raghunathan and these people working in resistive theorems a la Calabi-Vail. Because one important issue here is that the first symmetrization is the adjoint representation. Okay? So people, these kind of theorems are interesting for studying rigidity, but Raghunathan proved it more in more generality. And well, essentially you take the proof of Raghunathan or Matsushima Murakami essentially, and you say, okay, we have this acyclicity result, well, that's an L2 theorem, blah blah, and we twist by a unit complex number, and all these theorems are use Hermitian spaces and so on. It doesn't change anything to the proof. From the Hermitian point of view, multiplying by a unit complex number doesn't change things that much. So here I'm really using that the normals, I'm really using this hypothesis, is that this has norm 1 to say that this is it. And that's the first step to make things work. Otherwise, you don't know well how to relate Alexander polynomials and torsions and so on. So a consequence of this vanishing theorem is that, well, when n is even, the evaluation of the twist Alexander polynomial is 1 over the torsion of this twist representation, rho n twist tensorized by the twist. I call this map of the twist. And in the odd dimensional case, well, we have a subtility at theta minus 1. Okay? It's important that all this is in absolute value. Yeah? Otherwise, distortion is not really well defined. I need to take the absolute value, but it's okay. This will not change anything for the asymptotic behavior, because it's always the same factor. Okay, so for the asymptotic behavior, I really need to care about distortion. With or without this, it doesn't change anything. Okay. So let's discuss the asymptotic behavior. So that's the notation I'm using, sigma n and rho n. The theorem of Mueller for closed manifolds is this product, this limit is minus 1 over the volume. This is the theorem of Mueller, but I will discuss the proof now, soon. Then, for not exteriors, we got this, the same theorem from Mueller's theorem. And now what I want to discuss today, or what we are working on, is this Alexander polynomial. And here you see have minus minus, and here you don't have a minus. And this is why, because the Alexander polynomial is 1 over the torsion. And what I will discuss really is a theorem again on radial torsion. So from here to here, I introduce the twist. And that's what's really new, okay? So my plan from the rest of my talk, I still have some minutes, a lot of time, is to discuss the Mueller approach, how to adapt it for closed manifolds, and for knots, and the idea will be to use hyperbolic filling. And what to do in this case, where hyperbolic filling has to be a little bit more sophisticated. So let me discuss Mueller's theorem, Mueller's proof of his theorem. So I forget about the twist, it's just 1, and just for a closed manifold. Okay, you have this limit. So here it comes the role of Mueller's theta functions. So I don't work only with, we work with two kinds of Mueller's theta functions. the ones that are just defining. So PCGM means primitive closure decids of M, unoriented. So we have this product of determinants. And here I have this R, well, maybe, yes, it's a 2K, yeah. Because I will discuss just one case. R2K is this product of 1 minus this factor here. Theta is what? If you take the complex length of a geodesic, L is the length, and theta is the torsion factor or the twist factor. I put it here and put the length here. And the first thing, well, that's another formal sum that converges for large, for real part of S-labs, formal product, sorry. These are determinants, these are not determinants, I have this formula. What does this formula say? This formula says that if you take the determinant of a matrix, it's the product of the eigenvalues. Okay, because you have to imagine, if you take the determinant of 1 minus this matrix, for instance, if you take, you will take 1 minus this eigen, well, this is the wrong case. Let's say this one. 1 minus this eigenvalue times minus 1 minus this eigenvalue, 1 minus this eigenvalue, 1 minus this eigenvalue. So, if you, here you have the this representation, this drawing, I forget about drawing, sorry. Well, drawing is here. What are the eigenvalues of this matrix? Well, here you have this A is in one half of the complex length, L plus E theta. So eigenvalues are the one half L plus E theta. So when you take the eigenvalues of this, you have this theta, you have this L, and you find this form. Well, this is, you have to take care that this is an infinite product and that this works. Okay, you have this decomposition. And now, well, that's a formula which is not so difficult to prove for well, the zeta functions. But now the true ingredients of the proof are these are two theorems. The first one is this is Fried's theorem or the generalizes of Fried's theorem that the evaluation at zero at the origin is the square of the eigenmaster of the torsion, analytical torsion. And the other one is this functional equation, and here's where the volume appears. So if you switch the sign of S and K, you have the exponential of the volume, 4 times the volume times S over pi. And these are the two terms that will relate torsion and volume. And you have to work with this, okay? So I'm hitting the Fried's theorem, because I'm not discussing the proof of that or the proof of that. But these are really the Fried's theorem. So this is a dynamical theorem proved by Fried, the unit on the geodesic flow, and that's this was proved by Mueller using the Lefschetz trace inequalities and so on. So that's, these are these theorems. When you have these two results, it's not difficult to prove the theorem in the closed case. Because because the formulas are becoming complicated, but what I introduced here, well, you have two formulas, one in the even, one in the odd case. Yeah, because well, the eigenvalues really change, but if you take here the four-dimensional one, and here you have 2n dimensional representation, using these formulas, you can easily prove this that this quotient of logarithms of absolute values is from one side. You have the summation of all the functions, the small ones, okay, and somehow using the functional equation, here you have this term with the volume and some means that multiply. I'm sorry because I'm confusing the notation because this n here is twice n here, yeah, because I have 2n here. Okay, so in fact, this is why there is a 4 pi, and here it is only 1 over pi. Because I believe that if I was putting 2n here, so I would put 2n and 2n, and here I would put a 4. I'm sorry. And what you need to prove is that this is bounded, but then this is not hard to prove, that this is bounded uniformly. Given a manifold, this does not. Independent of K and independent of N, I guess. Yeah. It should be an N. This is why I didn't give you the slides, printed the slides now. Because the definitive version will be after the talk, because the mistakes I find in the talk. Okay, this should be an end. So the idea is to, the ingredients are these, and this is just an elementary manipulation. Okay? And this is going to prove the theorem. So what you want to do now for a not complement or for a cast manifold is to prove the same formula. Yeah? To prove the same formula, because, well, we don't have this theorem, but here the big rule is that a function is not appearing anymore. And this kind of things, you want to use this formula, and from this formula approximate, study it for them fillings. And from the them fillings we'll get a theorem on the manifold. Okay, so let me explain that. So I have my note, a key k pay over q, key times a rational number, that's a pq then filling, or p over q then filling, and that's the notation of the filling. A first concern says that, well, it's hyper, this note is, this then filling is hyperbolic, or then surgery is always, almost always hyperbolic, and I have a geometric limit for the geometric topology, whatever this means. Okay? In particular, the volume converges to the volume. But I need more information because I had these formulas with geodesics. So here's the result for the length spectrum. So I take the complex length of oriented prime cross geodesics, and I tell them the following thing. So if I take a compact set here, it means that I take all geodesics with bounded length below and above. Establish some bound, then this complex length spectrum will converge to the complex length spectrum of the node. And here you need to do some hyperbolic geometry. And in fact, I'm supposed to use this. I'm just going to make picture of manifolds. So what's the then filling doing? So you have your then filling, key p over q. That's a manifold with a very short geodesic that it's going to develop a cusp. So here you have a short geodesic. And it's going to converge to a cusp. So, but you have Margulis theorem. Margulis theorem says that besides some injectivity radius, so here you fit some epsilon and some length, this is in fact a topology. Besides some injectivity radius, all geodesics contain it here. Well, this is the only geodesic still contained here. So in your Margulis neighborhood, you only have one geodesic that is still contained in there, it's the short geodesic. So if you truncate along some neighborhood of the short geodesic, you know that all other geodesics that meet here, they have to be very long. So this distance is long. And if you have a short geodesic going there, you have a geodesic going there, it has to be very long. So if you establish some maximum of the length, you say that at some point you will have the same geodesics in your manifold up to some length that in your cast manifold for geodesics up to some length, okay? So you need to use these properties of the spectrum, and then everything will converge. Everything will behave well. Mm-hmm. So let me quickly give you the formulas. So this is the formula we established, that's the formula of Mueller for the then filling. So when I write P over Q means that it makes reference to the then filling, so that's the holonomy of the then filling. And I have this ratio this logarithm of ratio of Riemannian torsions. This is sum of small order functions minus 1 over 5 of pi times the volume of this. So what do with this formula? We decompose, to the Riemannian torsion and apply my iterators. So I decompose my filling into the complement of the knot and the short geodesic, which is this gamma p over q should be written gamma p over q. And I say, okay, here I just apply my iteratory so that the torsion is a product of torsion, so a logarithm will be the sum. So in one side I will have, so I have two terms, the term to the that corresponds to the exterior of the knot, and the term that corresponds to the shortest radius. Okay? And you can write something like this, which is very similar to the Rolle functions. Okay, so the first term, this is convergent, because these holonomy representations are really on the character variety of the exterior of the knot, they are really convergent to the holonomy of my hyperbolic manifolds. Well, in fact, you have to be careful which thing you choose, but everything, you can do that. Well, and the other term, what happens to the other term? The other term will cancel with some of these functions, yeah? Because here I'm summing along all geodesics of the term filling. And here, if I remove this, here I'm really removing the short geodesic term. And then you have to work out a little bit and show that this is going to converge to the Rolle function for the custom. Okay. So I remove the short geodesic. Oops, sorry. And I have these limits of Rolle functions. And here I'm using the properties of the spectrum and so on that I'm skipping a little bit. Okay. So what do we get? We get the formula for the Casse manifold. And that's the theorem that we proved with Menal-Ferrer some years ago. But now we want to generalize this. And now we are not cut. We want to take this twist torsion, so the representation is rho n. Oops, I wrote it here. Is theta twist by rho n. But I have a problem with the filling, right? Because now rowing was approximated. The holonomies are approximated. But if I take this map, even if theta has norm one, it will not factorize through the filling. Yeah, that's you know that. Yeah, when I do a filling, then such a manifold, I almost always get a rational homology sphere. And here I just generate a unit complex number one. So I have to do another kind of filling. So there is only one surgery that works. That's the zero surgery. If I kill the longitude, then I still have a surjection into zero. And what I do is, instead of the fillings, I will do orbifold for the fillings. Orbifold for the fillings means that I do always the same filling with the slope zero. So along the filling curve will be the longitude, but it will put some branching. So we are not attaching solid torus, but singular solid torus, with a singular geodesic in its way. And, well, in this way, this map will still factor through a surjection from the orbifold field. So that's the orbifold fundamental rule. And in terms of hyperbolic geometry, everything is going to work well. Oh, you have to be a little bit. Well, for large Q, this is going to be hyperbolic. That's Thurston's theorem again. This is going to converge. That's convergence. You have to be careful with the least holonomy. But because when you have torsion, you have to watch out. But just take Q out and everything works. Everything works because you have maybe. Oops. Okay, when you have your singular locus and you have this rotation, here you put e pi I over q, 0, 0, e pi I over q. That's a minus, okay? You say, okay, the q power of this is minus 1. No, because you have a minus here. Because the holonomy, the lift of the holonomy, it's a parabolic element with trace. There is always, sorry, the lift of the holonomy of the longitude, it's a parabolic element with trace minus 2 always. Yeah, well, it's just a subtle point, but it works. And then, I will not give you the details because we are still writing this, but you have geometric convergence, everything is fine, but you have to be careful with the analytic side. Yeah, because things are not so clear. So, especially with the Rolle functions. So, for instance, there is no Cheeger-Mueller theorem for orbifold in general. But there is an equivariant Cheeger-Mueller theorem due to due to bismuth and zinc, and it will work in this case, yeah? Because we have orbifolds which are very good, we have a Selberg lemma, and we'll have the Kibarian version of, there is an Kibarian version of Chigger-Mueller theorem that says that analytic and Rademacher selectors are the same. You have to work out Fitts formula, which were the two ingredients and the functional equation. Everything works, but you have to be careful and all that. So it requires some analysis. And the twist, but the argument is going to be essentially the same, but you have to work a little bit more, somehow more. But you have to use that enormous one. Right? At some point, we had an acyclicity theorem that is essentially to Raghunathan. If the norm is one, it's not working. But also many things, you need it for many things. Eh? To be the torsion to be well defined, the Chigger-Mueller theorem works well with this hypothesis, etc., etc. So this hypothesis is essential. But the output is the same, eh? It's the same limit and so on. And I will finish here. Thank you.
Any question?
Yeah. No.
So in Mueller's prisons as well in yours, you divide by n squared, right?
Mm-hmm.
Instead of n in, I mean, I think here your representation, they are not unitary. If they are unitary representation, just like a finite curve, then you divide by n of it to get the correct approach. So do you have any intuition why it must be n squared there?
No. Okay. I'm having a hard time having intuition with this Mueller work. So I'm just starting to understand things now. But no, but if you want to have an end, you have to work with something different. Maybe with some Rolle function you will have an end. I mean, if really the idea is that Rademacher torsion is maybe my intuition would be that this Rademacher torsion is a product of you're combining two things when you take this. Let's say, you're combining two things. Is that when you take in these representations? You have an n which is growing here, but you take, it's like, and then you take the product of this. It's like summing. It's just, you sum some n's and then you take the n squared. Yeah, maybe then, so if you put some n and the logarithms and the sum, and you have n terms, and you get some n times n plus 1 over 2 or something like this. That's my intuition. But maybe there is a theorem just using Rolle functions or like this. That you can state, yeah.
Yeah. So for unitary representation, probably, I mean, they all one there since.
Right? No, but they are
not looked at.
Yeah. Right. For unitary representation, you have ones there, and yeah, that's a good point. And you have just the sum of n terms. Here, our representations are far from unitary, so yeah, that's a good point.
Another question?
You choose particular. Can
you
associate
to
hyperbolic structure?
Yes.
So can you extend this?
No. I cannot. I definitely cannot. I mean, the question makes a lot of sense, but I'm really using these theorems of analysis of compact manifolds, or compact orbifolds, if you want. So I really need an extractor that. Okay, you can say, I'm approximating by them feelings, I'm approximating by orbifolds. For these points, I have Mueller's theorem, or Mueller's version of theorem for orbifolds. But generically, in the then filling space, if I have a point which has not accumulation of of these kind of points, I don't know how to do it.
Close to the manifold, there are some discrete other.
Yeah. This, you can even take. It's discrete accumulating. It's discrete if you remove the complete structure. Yeah, countable. But in general, without using this, you need analytic torsion. I don't know how to do it without analytic torsion. Yeah.
So
there some simplification on zetas minus one?
Yes. The simplification is you have a Fox formula. You know Fox formula for the homology of Ranciocol? You have it for eigenvector torsion. And when you take the twist Alexander polynomial at one is the torsion, is the plane torsion. Twist Alexander polynomial evaluated at one times evaluation at minus one, that's the torsion of the double coupling. And here you apply Mueller's theorem or whatever theorem, and it's simple. So evaluation at minus one, we knew it. Evaluation of the square root of minus one, we knew it by taking, because that's the value and so on. And some simple roots, yes. This is what made us believe that this was true for roots of unity, and then we realized that maybe it's true for unit complex numbers.
Can you generalize your results to any link couple?
Yeah. But you have to be. I cannot take any abelianization map to define the. I need some hypotheses on the abelianization map to define the polynomial. It's not just taking abelianization and all variables. It would not work in general. Well, it will work in general if I take a polynomial, a link, with linking number zero. If the linking number of the component is zero, everything is fine. But if the linking number of the component is non-zero, it's a big mess. Well, I need to do the fillings. So I need that some curves play the role of the longitude. And if the linking numbers are zero, I have nice longitudes. If the linking numbers are not zero, I have to watch out.
Mainly, the issue is topological.
It's my limitations too. Yeah, it's the limitation of this approach. I don't have a reason why, without my hypothesis, it wouldn't work. It's what I can prove. It's not the same thing. Yeah, maybe it's wrong, but. One thing is what I can prove, one thing is what is wrong, what should not go. There's always a gap between what you can prove and what you think should be true.
So far we can stop the questions here and corner Joan at coffee outside.
One quick question, where can we find your slides?
How do you call when you put all the slides together and so on? When I have an internet connection that works,
yeah.
And this will be in more than 1 week, I will send you my slides and I will put them on the web page. But for the moment, it's hard, yeah, to put this on the web. It's hard from here. And how is it?
I'm sorry, Francis. I'm sorry.
Thank you. I will do that.
Yeah, no, it's
a fair question. Yeah.
Okay, and so we can thank Joan again.